From the United Nations Office to the African Union, this is She Stands for Peace, a podcast series where I explore the state of the women, peace and security agenda in Africa through a series of conversations with key actors. In the podcast, we ask the central question, 20 years after UNSCR 1325, how far have we come? I'm Dr. Yemisi Akinbobola, your host, and today I'm joined by Bintu Keita, Special Representative of the Secretary General and Head of the United Nations Organization Stabilization Mission in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, otherwise known as MONUSCO. SRSG Keita joins me from Kinshasa, the capital of the Democratic Republic of the Congo, and we have a conversation about her work and her reflections on local ownership of peacekeeping, which we've summarized as glocalizing peace. SRSG Keita, it's a pleasure to talk to you today. Am I right in saying that your journey with the United Nations started with UNICEF in the late 80s?
Thank you for having me. Actually, my journey started with UNDP, the United Nations Development Programme, and this was in 87. And from there, I went and worked with SIDA Canada in my home country, in Guinea, and started working in Chad on September 89 with UNICEF. At that time, I was responsible for a number of projects.
So tell us about those early years in UNICEF and your work at that time.
6 months after arriving in Chad, I wanted to resign from UNICEF because I thought these people are just crazy. We are supposed to be working for children, and we spend a lot of time in office preparing papers and preparing documents for fundraising. And I was not too sure that this is what I wanted to do, because for me, it's very important to connect with the reality on the ground, to meet people. So I told one of my supervisors, look, I don't think I want to continue with UNICEF. The representative at that time, Mr. Alan Court, called me and said, come in my office and we are going to chat. And he looked at me and he said, what exactly is going on? I hear that you want to resign, etc. So I explained what I just said. He looked at me and he said, give us 6 additional months. If you still want to resign, I will let you go. After 6 additional months, I enjoyed, because I was able now to go in the field everywhere in Chad, and it was helping me keeping the purpose of why I was there. This is something which for me was very important, which don't give up too early. You have to understand the culture.
Yeah, absolutely. And then also that need to be in the field, to be a part of the reality of the documents and the things you are putting together.
Exactly.
You spent 3 years in Burundi as Deputy Executive Representative at the United Nations Integrated Office there, and which took over from the United Nations operations after the president at the time, Pierre Nkurunziza, asked him to leave. So your office had many things to deal with, but mainly overseeing the ceasefire between the government and the rebel group FNL. There were many times where talks, you know, broke down, several instances of resumptions of fighting. And your office was also there to support through the election process. Reflecting on that time, can you describe what was it like each time the promise of peace disintegrated into conflict?
Actually, very painful, because you see the population and you see the women, the children, the young people. And every time there is hope, you think that you are going to cross the bridge. And then you kind of stay in the middle of the bridge and you go nowhere. In reflecting back, I also learned a lot what not to do. I was the only woman in the political directorate at that time. So with a number of ambassadors and the head of the mission, Youssef Mahmoud, who we were negotiating with Panepeutu FNL, Agathon Rwasa, and his spokesperson, Pastor. And one day, Pastor called me and he said, please, can you come with me? I have something to tell you. He said, Madam Keita, all the people in the room, they want to do their best in order to broker peace with Palipeutu FNL, because we have to transform them from a rebel group into a political party. And there are so many steps that need to happen. But even if you have good ideas and it's good project for us, if it's not done with us buying in and being part of the ideas, then we will consider that every single person in this room is our enemy. I was like, wow. So which meant it framed the way I looked at brokering, negotiations and deals, which is really about putting ourselves in the place of the people we are working with in order not to take over the process of thinking, the process of designing the future for themselves. So not projecting what we believe is the best, rather listening, and ensuring that we are able, a bit like Socrates, kind of have them becoming pregnant of their own ideas and delivering their own ideas and being accompanied by the United Nations, by the international community, and not the other way around. For me, this was something which I really took with me. And all these years, I'm always concerned when someone comes and say, here is a product, I've reflected, I've put everything down, take it, and now I'm a PR and I'm selling something to you. And I'm like, this doesn't hold. You need to take people where they are and you step by step understand them, where they want to go, you advise, and then you can move along. So actually we manage between 2007 up to 2009, we were able, in spite of everything, to accomplish what we intended to do, which was to transform Palipeo to FNL into a political party who now participated in the 2010 elections and decided to withdraw once again. So this was a blow to all of us because this was a community level elections, and they decided that the elections rigged, and this explains later some of the setbacks again for Burundi.
And it's interesting what you said there about local ownership and the voices and the perspective of those people who are involved on the table. And also from your perspective as the only woman amongst your team of peacekeepers, peace builders in the room, were there also kind of gender disparities across the people in the room from the perspective of FNL and the government as well?
Oh, yes, definitely, because there was another woman in the room. She was, I think, the ambassador for Netherlands. And every time there would be something like a break, or they would say, oh, can we have, so they would just turn and look at us like, you know, please, can we have tea, coffee, or things like this? I was like, no, this is not our role. We are here at the same level as you, engage in the conversation, contributing to the conversation, and also having ideas in terms of how to help the two parties broke a deal. And interestingly, the person who is now the president of the Republic in Burundi was the chief negotiator at that time, Evariste Ndayishimiye, now he's the president. So I kind of journeyed with him through the negotiations, and now I have like a privileged quote-unquote relationship because of all the work that we did together.
On the issue of the disparities between the gender representation at the table, do you think it's improved since then?
Unfortunately, I am not sure that there is progress of the number of women around the tables when there are negotiations. For some reason, it seems that it is a systemic issue. You have your ambassadors, mostly the ambassadors are men. You look at the delegations of different member states, mostly they are men. So even when we do like a global call and saying in 2017 with the notion that the Secretary General wanted to achieve gender parity strategy and saying to the member state, please, we are trying to have to create a roster for number of men and women to be able to be deployed in the field for special political mission or for peacekeeping mission. So please, when you are sending your name, send men and women. Unfortunately, when we kind of went through the nominations, some people did not even bother. Member states did not even bother. It was one man and that's it. And some were only men. So with that as a back as a backbone of the system, so it becomes very difficult when it comes to negotiation to say, okay, where are the women in the system? And when it comes to mediators, again, I was in Burundi at that time, and I went to Addis for a meeting, and I was looking around the table. I think we were like three or four women, and it was a huge meeting about peace and security. And one of the women is now the president of Ethiopia. But the thing which was amazing, not in a good sense to me, was the fact that you could see that the generation these men were coming from was very old. At that time, he didn't have gray hair. And I was like, okay, so how do we prepare the next generation? We prepare the room or the table in order to bring more women by also offering them the opportunity to become mediators and negotiators of peace in conflict setting. But it's not something which is automatic. We still have a number of barriers to overcome.
I mean, looking at your profile and the amazing work you've done, you're one of those kind of beacon of hope, so to speak, in terms of where we can actually get to. You were Deputy Joint Special Representative of the African Union and UN Hybrid Operations in Darfur, UNAMID. And when you were at UNAMID, what struck me was the size of that mission, right? So you had 13.5 military troops, 180 military observers, 3,500 police officers, 2,500 or more than 2,500 civilians, and a budget of over $1 billion. And you were the Deputy Joint Special Representative of it. What was it like leading such a large peacekeeping unit?
Very daunting at times, and particularly in my role, which was about protection of civilians, not just from a military perspective, but also ensuring that we had the children perspective, the women perspective, the gender perspective, and also, again, not taking the internally displaced people. At that time when I was there, we had more than 1.6 million of internally displaced people living in camps or gathering sites. But the totality of the internally displaced people were more than 2,600,000. So just to think, how do you provide protection around gathering sites without transforming the people into these camps as like a quote-unquote, for me, a kind of a prison? I'm sorry to frame it that way, because it's a safe place, it's a secure place, but at the same time, you don't feel very able to move freely, to move around, to do your activities like a normal day of any human being, because you always have to think about different considerations. But actually, between the time I went there and the time I left, by being in contact with the people we serve, going to the remote locations, spending time with the military and the foreign police unit in the various sites, and particularly the most remote, because for me, it was also a way to support, to boost the morale of the soldiers, of the police, and also the civilians who were living in very dire situation, trying to deliver the mandate, actually. I felt that it kind of shifted this notion that you are in bunkers and you stay in the bunkers and you still do your job. And also the other thing is thinking about protection with the agency's funds and programs, thinking about it in the totality of the United Nations, coming and coalescing efforts in order to deliver basic social services and thinking about durable solutions for the internally displaced people, and thinking about the intergenerational aspect of those who came in a camp. They were babies and now they were grown up. When I say grown up, like young people who have married themselves and then they have kids and everyone stuck.
And still speaking on South Sudan, When you were Assistant Secretary General for Peace Operations, you spoke to the press about the humanitarian situation in South Sudan. This was around April 2018. And I'll quote you, you said, "Peace will not be won in Addis Ababa only. It has to be won in every state of the country where politically motivated intercommunal violence has become a great source of concern and has caused numerous fatalities in the past month." End quote. Now, in that situation, you were speaking about South Sudan and you mentioned Addis Ababa because the peace talks was holding in Ethiopia at the time. But that statement from you strikes me as what we've been saying all along in terms of that fundamental challenge in the peace process, the difference between the talks and the resolutions, the mandates, and the actual local ownership and implementation. So what has your experience taught you about how we can do better with implementation, transferring the talks and the resolutions to actual practical local ownership and implementation?
You have to challenge the mindset and the thinking about you get into a room, which is great. You have to do that. But the internalization of what needs to happen on the ground at community level, you cannot just be here in the on the top of the mountain and you are thinking and you are looking down and you are thinking, okay, this is going to trickle down to the communities because the fabric of the society is not up. It's in the homes, in the camps, in the villages. So we have to find a way to connect the two. And for this, I kind of sense that more and more there is more movement out there, civil society organizations and NGOs who are challenging the system. And we hear a number of voices of young people and also young men and women who are saying, if we keep doing the same thing which has been done over centuries, because it has been taught in schools and we have textbooks and we keep doing the same thing and we keep having results where we are seeing the world going in a direction which is not necessarily where we want to be. So why don't we pause and say, what would it take for all of us to reflect on the way we approach peace in any part of the world and we rethink how the global governance framework is fitted or no longer fitted. I tend to go to no longer fitted with the dynamics which have come now in the 21st century DNA with this digitalization of the world and the interconnectivity. Even when there is no electricity, I can tell you with on their phones, the people get to react to things that are not necessarily in their own place, but to global level. So the global, for me, is important as a concept. Now, how do we do it? Not just business-oriented global, so what is considered global level, we have it local, but from what I shared with you, which is, for me, the ownership, the internalization of vision and the society that the people want to go about, we have to be respectful of all of this. And I sometimes feel that we are very arrogant in the way we approach the people at the community level. So the ones that are succeeding at community level are the ones who are humble enough to say, not to create even more barriers, but to live with the community, to understand the communities, and to, again, I always talk about accompanying, which is more difficult than just ordering, giving instructions, and saying, okay, here's the template, go. It's easy to do, but the day you are not there, it goes back to where it was. And so it's not helping.
And I love what you said there about the globalization of peace processes. I think that's a fantastic segue to talk about what's going on now in the world, battling with the pandemic, right? And many African states are now working to coordinate vaccinations and other means of controlling the spread of COVID-19. And I want to take you back to 2015, when you were in Sierra Leone as the UN's Ebola crisis manager there. That was an epidemic that reportedly started in Guinea, spread across several countries, Sierra Leone, Liberia. And while there is a vaccine, it's something that still continues to spread in different countries. So in North Kivu, and I understand there's an outbreak there currently. So when you reflect on your time in Sierra Leone during the Ebola epidemic and thinking about the current COVID-19 pandemic, in your opinion, what did we learn about the impact of health crises in peace processes?
During the Ebola time, I learned one thing. We have to be humble on what we know versus what we don't know, because this was a novelty. And somehow the approach at the very beginning was, we know what to do, and we tell everyone, communities and individuals, this is what you have to do, and we will get rid of Ebola. And actually, scientifically, the knowledge evolved. So we had to kind of backtrack a number of messages that we were providing to the communities on how to protect themselves, the barriers to getting Ebola, the safe burials, and respecting, understanding the rituals, how to provide alternative means for the people to mourn their dead people, and also having a way to create when it was not possible to bury people in a very individualized manner, to still think through how you manage cemeteries in a way which later, when situation is more quiet, for the communities to be able to come and see that there is still a place, even if it's a mass grave, to grieve. So for the global pandemic, I kind of was upset, because at the very beginning, the message were kind of similar to Ebola, very forceful, this is what you have to do. And then we started having all this unraveling of the even the scientific information. One would say, wear a mask. Another one would say, don't wear a mask. Get into washing your hands on the continent. Well, fine, but we have one big challenge, is access to water. We don't have access to water everywhere. And then social distance. And you see, and this is what is for me amazing. Could we not think through in places where the density of the population and the way they are living is not going to provide them the space to social distance? So all of these things for me is just, again, a reminder that scientific knowledge is only good when people are able to translate what it means in different contexts and contextualize how people can go about protecting themselves, protecting their loved ones, and protecting their communities in a sense. So in a context of peace, unfortunately, it's like, the Trojan horse. A lot of excuses are being taken from the existence of COVID, which from a health perspective is not quite respected, because they have other survival, their day-to-day survival issues. So they look at it and say, okay, so yes, quarantine, thank you very much. So how do I do so? Because for me, I go every day and I get something, and then I can feed myself and I can feed my family. So to not go through the motion of putting ourselves in the shoes of the people in various locations and thinking through how we translate the scientific knowledge for them to provide alternatives in a way they can still take care, I'm kind of, really pissed off.
That's a good summation of exactly how you feel, and that's absolutely fine. I think at the beginning of the pandemic, when they were talking about social distancing and things, and I was just thinking about the way some of our houses in African countries are. In Nigeria, you have this face me, I face you kind of one singular building, where how are you going to isolate from a second household? So what you're saying is quite right. And speaking about local context and working locally, you're just a few months in your post at MONUSCO in DRC, and you're facing protests and violence towards your peacekeepers. How do you tackle such situations where those local people that you're trying to work with feel a level of distrust towards peacekeepers?
The first thing is to stop and listen to what they are saying and how they are expressing it. So clearly there is anger, there is frustration and lack of trust that something is going to be different. It's a cry for help. Basically, it means that you have to find a way to connect again in various ways, at various levels within the mission, and not just the mission, also the international community, the member state composing the Security Council and others, to recognize that there is a legitimate way this anger is coming from. So it's now up to us to find ways, not necessarily to gain back the trust immediately, because it will take time, slowly, slowly finding ways to say, we really understand, we are in compassion with you, and we will do our level best to try to go after the armed groups that are harming you. This is what I can say, because if I just take it as, oh, it's anti-MONUSCO, and it's like everyone is anti-MONUSCO, the portrayal is not right either. Because I've been in many places where people like MONUSCO, want MONUSCO to stay. But again, I understand that from a journalistic perspective, it's much easier to throw something which is, okay, anti-MONUSCO, so everyone is going to take the newspaper, rather than, okay, there is this, and there is also positive things that are going on in our DRC.
Another thing about the DRC is that it's a perfect example that demonstrates how much work continues in peace building and peacekeeping even after the official end of a conflict. So the civil war officially ended in 2003. And yet there's still violence. According to the Kivu security tracker, there's been almost 4,500 violent deaths and over 5,000 cases of abduction since 2017 in eastern DRC. And in the few months you've been in DRC, you've been working towards the withdrawal of MONUSCO from Kasai, one of the provinces of the country. So how do actors of the Women, Peace and Security agenda, how do we improve in bringing the violence to an end at a faster rate and post-conflict?
This is a huge question. At a faster rate, I'm like, human nature is not going to be fast. To destroy, it's going to be fast. But to go with the notion of there is something which is about peace, I almost think we have to start with parenting. We have to start with our preschool, school, university, college, and all of this to kind of nurture this. But it's like an endeavor which is not fast-tracking, I'm afraid. This is my vision. If really we want another world and post-conflict situation, the investment in education, the investment in parenting is absolutely key. And then you have to think about some of the grievances that are fueling violence and some of the economic situations that are also fueling violence. But then it means that we have to be able to go at scale with the sustainable development goals, not this patchy way where we do things. There is no real large-scale results and impact on the life, transforming the lives of the people. And then the other thing is silencing the guns. I do believe that there is something there, but are we serious enough to silence the gun? There are plenty of agreement to regulate the traffic of the small arms and weapons, light weapons, etc. But how effective are we with the traffic and everything? So for me, it's a combination of various tracks that we have to work on for the fast tracking, which is some of the things which is implementing agreements that already exist, making sure that we are tackling the issues of demobilization, disarmament, demobilization, and reintegration in a meaningful way. And we have to think through, not in terms of winning the minds and the hearts, but how do we prepare a next generation who is going to be managing, handling conflict differently.
This is my last question, and silencing the gun is a good point for us to kind of wrap things up, because that was the AU agenda and theme for last year, silencing the gun by 2020. And you've spoken a lot about the youth, about digitization. How have we done, particularly in relation to youth and also emerging technologies?
I think we have a long way to go to meaningfully engage the young people. And why I'm saying this, because everywhere I've been traveling in my previous function, I would be meeting women groups and I would be meeting young people groups. And the young people actually both have the same message. They're saying, we can do things at our level, at community level, which will be supporting peace consolidation and peace in our countries. But the donors and even the United Nations, they tend to approach the young people and the women groups like a charity business. I like this organization, so I give a bit of money. But the thing is, this is not sustainable. So both are saying, you know, what we need is program over 5 years of a commitment or committed engagement with sustaining funding where we are trusted. So the trust comes back again, which is not that I give you $10 and you do a report and then I give you. No, you kind of build capacities. You accompany again these groups in such a way that at some point financial management, reporting and all of this, they are aware of what the norms and the standards are, and they will be able at some point to connect to other source of funding, which is not the one which is depending on one donor who one day was probably investing, I don't know, in peace dialogue, and the next 6 months down the line says, oh no, I want to do something else, water. So it's a bit of a mix. I do believe that there is something we can do differently at scale, which is preparing them, those who are already engaged in their communities, training them, providing them certificate, coaching and mentoring them. And we've managed to do this at a very small scale when I was in New York. We did it for Darfur, we did it in Kenya and so many, but it's like one batch at a time. It's like 40, 50 young people that we are training and coaching and mentoring. But for me, thinking about electoral violence or violence in general, inter-community violence, if we were able to 10,000, 100,000 young people who are trained to know how to help their communities not go to the extreme. So this for me would be silencing the gun.
Brilliant. My final question, which I'm going to ask everybody on the podcast, is what can you tell us about yourself that we wouldn't find on Google? Who has been to Kenya at home?
Actually, I'm an artist. At home, I'm an artist. I love singing. I love dancing. I love writing poems. I love playing. So I guess if I was not in this role, probably I would be earning my money by being an artist.
Fantastic. I love it. Thank you so much, SRC Keita. It's been a pleasure speaking with you. And thank you so much for all your amazing insight on your work as well. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
You have been listening to She Stands for Peace, the podcast series that explores the state of the women peace and security agenda in Africa, asking the central question, 20 years after UNSCR 1325, how far have we come? I'm Dr. Yemisi Akinbobola, your host, and this podcast was produced by the United Nations Office to the African Union with the generous support of the Norwegian Ministry of Foreign Affairs.